Welcome to the Taylor Made Tasty podcast. I'm Taylor, retired serial quitter turned goal boss coach, speaker, and consultant. I believe a beautiful life starts with a beautiful mindset. Join me as we amplify confidence, resilience, and actionable tools on the road to quit quitting on you and your vision. You are worthy of your goals, so let's go get there. Hey y'all, welcome back to another episode of Taylor Made Tasty, the podcast. We are officially all up in the holidays, and with that can come some emotions, good or bad. With my guest, Melissa Rolfs, we will be discussing how to find freedom from using food to stuff feelings during this holiday season, talking through how to know if you use food to stuff your feelings, and what you can do today to begin to stop. The goal of this episode is to help break the bond that so many of us have between food and our feelings. A little bit about our guest, Melissa Rolfs is a certified holistic health and life coach, helping busy women break free from sugar and stress and emotional eating so they can be calm, confident, and in control around food, around sugar, in stressful situations, in their body, in their life. She is committed to empowering women to break free from dieting, emotional eating, and self-image issues so they can ditch the diet mentality and feel empowered in their own skin. After her own tumultuous history with food, withholding, and then later in life binging, she learned how to deal with the core issues around the broken relationship with food. As a result, she felt called to go to school and learn how to teach other women how to do the same. She graduated from the Health Coach Institute as a holistic health and life coach in 2018 and is the proud owner of Free to Be Coaching. She is a proud Boilermaker alumna living in Arizona with her husband Chad and two kiddos. Please help me welcome Melissa to the show and let's get into it. Hi, Melissa. Thank you for coming on the podcast today.
Of course. Thank you for having me, Taylor. I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, so the goal of this episode is to really help break the bond that so many of us have between food and our feelings. And we wrestle with the guilt of quote unquote eating our feelings, which truly seems just like a vicious cycle where we feel our feelings, we eat our feelings, and we feel guilty for doing so. And when emotions run high, turning to food for comfort, well, it happens, right, to all of us. So I think we're self-aware on some level, but can you offer some insight into how to know if and when we are using food to stuff our feelings?
For sure. I think a really good starting point for that, Taylor, is to ask, am I physically hungry? Because there's a difference between physical hunger and that emotional hunger or those cravings that might not be related to a physical need for food. Sometimes we maybe feel like we need more alone time, or we need more time with people, or we have a need or a craving and we identify it as a craving, but we don't ask ourselves the next question is, am I physically hungry? And that can be a really good starting point because physical hunger is going to look different than emotional hunger. So I think being able to differentiate between the two is a really good starting point to kind of create that awareness and see where you're at.
Yeah, absolutely. I guess, I think that's great in theory, right? And I feel like that we should constantly be asking that question a lot, because a lot of this comes from not even just maybe boredom or using food as a distraction, right? Like, let's think about the last few years when we were in our homes more often. You know, it was just the easy thing was to go into the kitchen, go into the pantry. So creating that self-awareness to be able to trigger you to ask that question, like, how can we start to master that, if you will?
Yeah, that's a great question, because I think so many of us have habits or relationships with food based around more than physical hunger, right? So I think really bringing awareness to that, and maybe even it's something as simple as putting, what one thing we do in coaching is we have anchors. And so putting anchors around you to kind of bring awareness to that. So that might look like having something on your phone or on your laptop, or even if you find yourself going more towards the pantry or the freezer for the ice cream, just putting a note and saying, what am I hungry for? Like just something to bring that awareness and to kind of keep it top of mind. Because I think we do get busy. We do get caught up in habits. We don't really slow down and ask ourselves if we're physically hungry and listen to our bodies. We just kind of get on autopilot. So that anchor serves as a way to kind of break that habit and bring awareness to, oh, wait, that's right. I was looking for, you know, cookies, but really I'm feeling lonely. So I should call a friend instead.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yes. Like you said, that autopilot of just, and that happens a lot too, when we're actually in the act of it, is like, we're mindlessly doing it. We're not even really paying attention to whatever it is that we're consuming. We're thinking about whatever it is that thing is, right? That we're really seeking out, right? We might be thinking about that or thinking about the 500 other things we need to do. But even in the act of it, sometimes we're not even present for what we're actually doing.
100%. And I think that's, you know, another piece is to ask, why am I not present? Why? What is distracting me? And kind of dig a little deeper and get to that why behind the why, and then give yourself space, permission, time to kind of process those things that come up. Because a lot of times there is something deeper going on and we might not even be aware of it. We just know that we feel a certain way, but until we dig a little deeper and ask, okay, what am I really feeling and what do I really need that I'm looking to food to satisfy? What is really underneath all of that?
Yeah, definitely. And even though we're talking about food, like a physical item, right? I can speak personally that in time where food is being used to stuff my feelings, if you will, it is much more of a mental act. And so like what beyond us, you know, seeking other things, whether it's like, I want a phone call with a friend or something else that we are using to emotionally eat, what is happening in our mind when we're using food this way?
Well, I kind of think it depends on what's going on, because our brains are designed to keep us safe. Like that's their job, is to keep us safe, right? And so they interconnect with the body and they communicate in different ways. But I think as far as the mindset goes, we are looking either to avoid something, whether it's pain or an emotion or, you know, maybe some experience that we've had that we're looking to stuff, because that's what I did. Maybe we're looking for that. But that's really kind of what's going on, is the brain is trying to keep us safe. And so it defaults to those ways to protect us. And that works well when we're in survival mode, but we don't want to live in survival mode. We want to thrive. And so I think really understanding more of what's going on, it's kind of doing that deep inner work, Taylor, of asking yourself those hard questions of, you know, what am I looking to escape from? What am I looking to avoid? What am I not dealing with? And kind of doing that work is really where that begins, and kind of what's happening in our minds is we're looking to avoid that pain and we're looking to feel good. We want to feel good. We want to feel alive and happy. And sometimes we use sugar or food to do that for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's a great point, is that we want this to be, okay, I'm going to, you know, people identify as an emotional eater and we want something that's just going to wave a magic wand and cure that, or there's a pill for that, or there's take this one course for that. But it really has to do with that deep inner work. And so a lot of these things that we're talking about, we're asking questions, right? We're asking questions for self-awareness and taking self-inventory and being, the more self-aware we are, the more accountable we can be to ourselves. And I think that's the hardest part, is that it's not something so easy where you can just say, do this, or, you know, put even like the anchor thing. That's a great tool, but it's not going to be like, oh, I'm cured. I'm never going to do this again because now I have this anchor. It's like the combination of all of these things working together, and then the practice of it, right? The consistency, the commitment to it, and the slip ups that happen, and being able to bounce back faster and all of that. But it's that deep inner work that either we're scared to do, or it seems like too much work, or we're just, we've never even, you know, there are some people that have never been in a place to even do deep work like that, where they're like, oh, hang out with myself, ask myself questions. No, thank you. So, you know, and that's the hard part about it, is that it's not just an easy, this is a deeply rooted, common, very common thing that many people deal with, but there is a lot of work that has to go into it to overcome that.
100%. And I think that's part of, you know, what we come up against in society, is we live in such a quick fix world, and everybody wants the quick fix and the solution. And I want the end all be all. And I want this thing that worked for my neighbor. And we're all different. We all have different circumstances. So I think it's really important to honor and acknowledge where you're at in your circumstance and what you need, because it's going to be different. Like, you and I are both female. You know, we live in generally the same part of the country, but we still have very different needs because we're different people. We have commonalities, but we also have differences, and we need to pay attention to those.
Yeah, absolutely. And the differences in your own life from season to season. Like, there may be times where you're a caretaker for somebody and emotional eating is like your outlet. And so it might be a little bit more prevalent at that time because of the circumstances of your life, and things won't always be the way they are, right? And so it's like knowing that we can come out of things and we can grow through things. And just because there's a time in your life that you, quote unquote, identified as an emotional eater, that's still like something that you can work through, and it, your season won't always be that way, right?
100%. Because I was there. Like, I was the overwhelmed mom living off of Oreos because I was exhausted and stuffing my feelings because I was home alone with these kids and I had spit up on me. And that was very much my vice then. But then, like you said, like, seasons change and you learn new strategies and new ways of being, and you have a different perspective, and it's just part of the journey. It's really beautiful.
Yeah, it is. It's hard and beautiful, but like, when you're growing through it, you know, it is beautiful. You're right. Mm-hmm. So now that we have a little bit of tools and like more self-awareness of the actual act of it and how it's affecting our mindset, what are some ways that we can acknowledge it in the moment? So we talked about anchoring, but like acknowledging it in the moment, like, what should our very next move be? So we're in the thick of, and I know it's different for everybody, right? It could be emotional eating from like a stressful day at work, or you just got some crazy bad news, or you're going through a breakup. Like, there's so many varieties of it, right? But like, what is a, I guess, more generalized next move to make when you are feeling that in the moment?
When you are feeling like you want to emotionally eat?
Yes.
And have you started emotionally eating, or you want to? Like, where are we at in the process?
Ooh, good question. Okay. You know, I think we kind of talked about the anchor, so that's like prior. Okay. So let's take this scenario from a, I'm already emotionally eating. I've now become self-aware of it. Like, I know it's, you know, maybe I was a little bit more mindful this time and I know what I'm doing. What would be something that like can take me out of this, or like the very next thing that I should be doing, as opposed to the shame spiral and the guilt trip and all of that? Yeah. What would be the next thing that would be helpful?
I think replacing judgment with curiosity, because like you mentioned, we are so quick to realize in the moment and then that shame spiral starts. But if we can even just, like, we have the awareness that we've been emotionally eating, if we can just pause and say, oh my gosh, I was emotionally eating. What am I looking for in this moment? What was the experience I was wanting to have? If we can get curious and we can replace that judgment that would have been, oh my gosh, I shouldn't have had this. I'm so terrible. I had another brownie, blah, 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 blah. Like that spiral that leads us nowhere good. If we can not go there, but we can replace that with curiosity, that can be really, really powerful.
Yeah, definitely. Again, this goes to the asking the questions, right? To getting to know yourself. And I think that's really what it's about, is like becoming an expert at your habits. Like, you're saying the curiosity. Okay, so, well, now I've done this act. I've had the emotional eating case scenario, whatever. I've had the cookies, whatever. And now being curious about what was it that brought me to that point? And what were my other options? And what could I, you know, if I could rewrite the story, what would I have done instead? What would I do differently? And so like us getting into those questions is really where we're going to see the benefits of it for the future, because we can also find commonalities amongst like when it's happening. So maybe it's every Friday because Fridays are crazy at work or whatever it is, like, or if it's a weekend thing. But the commonalities so that we know what to look out for when it happens in the future.
For sure. If we can identify our triggers, that can be really, really powerful. Because then when we have a situation where we're going to experience those triggers, we can be prepared. We can have a plan. I love to create like a nourishment menu with people so they have other options to pull from. If they do exactly what we talked about, they're caught in the, oh my gosh, I just emotionally ate, what do I need? Then they have a menu of other things they can pull from that's going to nourish themselves that don't involve food. Because usually there's something, again, going on. We've got to get to the root of it, of what are we really looking for in that moment.
Yeah, definitely. And I always coach when it comes to overall wellness with food specifically, because I think wellness has a lot of different branches and people get obsessed with the food part, but that we want to find sustainability and freedom. Like we don't want to feel, you know, as I said in the beginning, like breaking that bond that the food has on us is like, we don't want to feel that. We want to feel free. We want to feel in control. With many things in our life, but especially with food. Like I talk about this a lot during the holidays in my coaching. I'm like, so we're going to say that you said Oreo, right? We're going to say that Oreo, we are powerless. Like we are badass women running companies, raising kids, like doing all the things that we've been through. We have stood up time and time again, but we are powerless to this Oreo. Like that's it. When you think about it as simply as that, it sounds crazy that this Oreo has a hold on me. But it's true. That's the reality. And so like I mentioned, some people have this like deeply rooted bond between their emotions and food, but if we're looking at like long haul steps, we know this isn't something that's going to be cured overnight. We already talked about that. But like, what would be long haul steps for us, like to get to that freedom, to feeling that we do have a bit more control?
I think really doing the inner work and asking yourself the hard questions, Taylor, is really important. I think slowing down is really important. You need to give yourself permission to pause, to ask yourself the hard questions. Because again, we go back to autopilot and default. And when we give ourselves permission to pause and ask the hard questions, we can become aware of things we were doing we didn't even know that we were doing or where they came from. So I worked with a woman once who found herself, whenever she was really stressed, she would eat cheese and crackers, and she hated cheese and crackers. And we did some work together, and she discovered that she was going towards cheese and crackers because they signified a really happy time in childhood when her family was together and just really had happy memories. And so I think there is some memory association with food as well. So finding other ways to fill those memories without food can also be really helpful. I think listening to your body, I think having awareness around your triggers and other things you can do to nourish yourself when you do feel triggered can be really helpful as well. So I think those are just some things that people could walk away with this from and really implement going forward, especially starting right now.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I think that pause is going to be something that, so we're in the thick of the holidays, right? Which is an incredibly emotional time of year, whether that's happy or sad or angry or awkwardness or whatever, like there is the gamut of emotions that happen around the holidays, right? Grief is a huge one. You know, we're missing people that aren't there at the holiday table this year, right? All of those things that come into play. So that powerful pausing of being in control of the time in a matter of like your own time, of saying like, okay, I can take this. I can take 10 seconds. I can take 15 seconds and just like, breathe for a minute, because it is, we're already on go, go, go all the time. And now we're in a season that is even more go, go, go. We're being pulled in this direction, buying this, right? Like the social media, the marketing, the everything you have to go to, all the events and seeing the 500 different families you have to go to. So it's like already a crazy time that using that pause seems so powerful to give yourself permission to just, it's okay. I can pause for a minute and become more mindful of what I'm doing.
For sure, for sure. And there's another technique that might be really helpful too for your listeners. It's called the 5-5-7 breath. Are you familiar with that?
I'd love to hear about it. Thank you. Yes.
So what it does is it links your sympathetic nervous system with your parasympathetic nervous system. So when we feel out of control, our brains can do one thing and our bodies can do another. So this technique kind of brings the two back into balance and kind of helps us calm down overall. And it's beautiful because you could do this at family gatherings this holiday season. You could, you know, sit at the table with everybody and do this breath. And I don't think people would have to know you're doing it. You could even do it after the holidays as well if you're in the checkout lane and people are in the express lane with more than their 10 items and you're angry. Anyway, it's a great tool. But it's the 5-5-7 breath. And what you do is you breathe in for 5 seconds. You hold it for 5 seconds. And then you exhale for 7 seconds. So that exhale is longer than the inhale and the breathing in, and it kind of syncs things together.
Oh, that's beautiful. Yes. So is the idea of that to come back to your space or like calm you down in that moment?
100%. And even, you know, some people find it helpful to do this 3 times before they're about to eat. You know, if you find yourself maybe at the holiday table and you're like, oh my gosh, all the cookies and the pies and all the things, maybe just take a 5-5-7 breath 3 times and ask, am I really hungry? Do I want this right now?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think if that's like awkward for you, the bathroom, right?
For sure.
The restroom, like to excuse yourself, go to the restroom and do your 5-5-7 in there. I mean, you have like privacy in there. You're able to bring that mindfulness, bring that awareness to your breath by yourself, and then go out refreshed into your holidays. So I love that. Okay, that's our one simple tool for today. We always like, because some of these episodes, you know, can get really deep and it feels like a lot of work, and it is a lot of work, especially what we're talking about today. But I like to leave listeners with like one simple thing that they can do today. So the 5-5-7, it's easy to remember. We love that. So that's really good. And it's your birthday today. So happy birthday.
Thank you. It's crazy.
So on that note, I would love for you to share about your business and how listeners can connect with you.
For sure. For sure. Well, my business is Free to Be Coaching, and I'm all about helping women find freedom and feel at peace with food and their bodies and their lives, because so many of us have so much angst around that. And so that's what I do. You can find me at free2bcoaching.com, freetobecoaching.com. And I've got lots of gifts there. So please take advantage of the resources that are there. I have resources around emotional eating, around sugar. I never found myself emotionally eating carrots. So that's why there's something there for sugar as well. But just know that there's resources there to support you on your journey and kind of implement some of these things that we've talked about today.
Yeah, no judgment to the carrot community. Carrots are great, but I agree. So fantastic. Well, I'm excited for our listeners to connect with you. And this episode was so good about how to find freedom when using food to stuff feelings. So we thank you for being here today.
Thank you for having me.
All right, y'all, it is time for the quote of the episode. This quote is from Renee Jones, the author of What's Really Eating You? Overcome the Triggers of Comfort Eating. And the quote is, my mantra became, face your stuff, don't stuff your face. Take that into your week, your month, and maybe even your year, and use the tools from this episode to help you face your stuff this holiday season. As always, thank you for being here. Thank you for being in my community. I'm so glad you showed up today, and let's go get there. Look at you, crushing it. Thank you for joining me for another episode of the TaylorMade Tasty podcast. My hope is you always leave with a takeaway to implement in your own goal-crushing journey. I would love if you could take a moment to leave a review. And if you're looking for a community of goal boss badasses just like you, be sure to check out TaylorMadeTasty.com/membership.